Of you in here, nine of you in here, so I've got probably 10 to 15 hours invested for each of you in this project. This took a lot of work to put together. This information was very elusive. I mean, I scoured archives and, you know, random corners of the internet, and Dave was a great resource in helping identify some sources for me, and Ryan Claytor, who is a assistant professor at the University of Michigan and a professional artist, was incredibly helpful in helping me access some further resources. And there's a whole slide at the end that that lists all of the people that sort of lent assistance to this. But I will I'll say that this wouldn't have happened without the help of Dave and Ryan. We're almost to the end here. We're reaching the latter part of Ted's career. And then we'll rewind and go back to the beginning.
And this is credited games.
These are credited games. We'll get there. There's an expressway here, by the way. If you haven't played it yet, you should take the chance to do so. I think there's three other Zale games out there as well. A Wiggler, Gator, and Nippet. Thank you. Okay. So we're going to rewind all the way to the beginning. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Ted's ancestry and family history. May not be super interesting, I'll move through it quickly, but it's information that isn't out there anywhere else that I can find. And we're going to cover the following 10 or 12 points over the course of this presentation. So Ted was born into an immigrant family. His father was Boleslaw Joseph Zalewski. This comes into play, and I include it for a particular reason that we'll get to in a few minutes. His mother was a Nebraska girl. They were married in 1900 in Bay City, Michigan. And Ted was born Thaddeus Francis Zalewski. His family and friends referred to him as Thad, not Ted. Born on May 1st, 1901, and was the oldest of four children. Oh, I should also point out that official sources use Zalewski and Zaleski interchangeably. I know it's the same family because they list all of the children and other members of the household the same, so I don't know if that's the way the family was spelling it or somebody just transcribed it wrong. I mean, we're talking in, for the most part, about handwritten records. He was first married in 1923 at some point. I don't have a marriage certificate for him, but he married a woman named Muriel Kirsch, and they had a son named Robert, who just passed away a little less than 2 years ago. By 1935, and we'll come back around to this, there's a reason, by the way, why these points are here. By 1935, Ted's living in Chicago. Muriel has moved to Chickasaw, Oklahoma, and is working as a stenographer. And their son, Robert, by 1940, is living with his grandmother, Dora, and his uncle, Harry, in Oklahoma City. By 1951, Muriel has remarried. His second marriage was to Bernadine McConkie, until her death in 1947. Third marriage was to a woman named Inda. I was not able to determine what her maiden name was. And that lasted until his death in 1977. I do want to point out, Ted is an incredibly elusive guy, media shy, never did a lot of interviews or anything like that. And he's probably really upset with me right now for pulling all of this information together. This has sort of been a recurring thing as I've worked on this, you know. Here I am trying to find out more and dig up stuff about a guy who didn't want to be dug up. He died in September 1977 in Baxter, Arkansas, and he's buried at the Baxter Memorial Garden. All right. That's the family issue, the family stuff. Before pinball. So Ted, as you may or may not know, was in his 60s by the time he arrived at Valley. And in trying to peel back the layers of the onion, it's very challenging to figure out how he got into pinball. In the 1930 census, and I don't know how well you can read this, but he is a printer. There's a blow up of the same thing. I trimmed some of the columns there so you can see. And in 1930, he rented a home at 64 Howard Street in Lyons, Illinois. In 1930, he leaves Chicago. Don't know why. Pops up in the Milwaukee City Directory as a commercial printer. These documents are not dated, so I'm not sure if that came before or after the census slide that I just showed you. I suspect that it came after. He was in Chicago, made the move to Milwaukee, and ended up in both. By 1932, he's in Oshkosh, Wisconsin, and he's listed as an attendant. I don't know what that means. 1932, he moves again to Waterloo, Iowa, and he worked briefly in the restaurant industry. 1934, he's in Little Rock, Arkansas. He's sensing a pattern here as he moves south and is listed as a salesman. Sometime in 1934, as I pointed out before, he returns to Chicago, returns without his wife. By 1935, he purchases a home at 7752 Kingston Avenue. Building's gone. I tried to pull up pictures of it. I was not successful. Okay, 1940 census. Here he is. He is listed as the manager of a print house. There is a part of me that would like to think that the tie-in to pinball came through ad posters or one of the other design firms that was working in Chicago at the time. I cannot prove that. If any of you have a source that would prove that, I would be most appreciative to get my hands on it, because this is where things start to get a little murky. After 1940, by the way, here's a quote from Tropic Magazine in 1973. Next to Howard Hughes, America's most elusive and eccentric tycoon is Ted Zale, the designer emeritus and grand old man of the pinball industry. And that has proved absolutely true as I did this research. He is elusive. Okay, this is, you guys have probably, most of you, if you're a fan of Zale and a fan of pinball history, you've probably seen the Mother Was a Pinball article that appeared in Esquire. That's a quote from that. So he joined Bally in 1962. after quitting a job with a firm he decided was hopelessly conservative now. One of the things that I'm still trying to do is bridge the gap, and I'm jumping ahead a little bit, and then we'll go back. Bridge the gap for where that 15 years, actually this isn't the quote for 15 years, there's another quote that said he had been in the business for 15 years, how 15 years rewinds in the 60s back sometime in the late 40s. And that's where the trail goes cold. So we'll talk some about Zale firsts. Here's a list of the things, and actually one of these slides is incorrect. Dave and I determined yesterday. And I'll talk about that when we get there. This is came from a conversation that Dave was able to provide me with Greg Kubik, talking about the mechanisms. One of the things that's really remarkable about Zale's career is not only did he turn out an incredible number of innovative designs and new mechanisms. We were joking about the Balligator from Nippon earlier. He was turning out a pinball machine on average about every 45 days. So these guys talk about machines now and they say, oh yeah, you know, we did something amazing and pulled it together in 6 months or in a year. This was an ongoing, and as Greg points out, 24-hour testing of pinball mechanisms. I mean, they were going full bore with Ted's designs from early 1963 until sometime in 1969 or 70. We'll talk more about that as well. At any given time, Ted had roughly 5 Whitewoods that were ready to go, awaiting artwork, awaiting the okay from the bean counters that the earlier presenters were talking about. And he didn't care if a game didn't test well, because he always had another one in the wings ready to back it up. And at the time, he was the only designer at Bally. And that would last until 1967, 68 or so. One of the things that he did, and he is not the first to use 50-volt coils, but Bally was the first to standardize the use of 50-volt coils. Williams had done some machines earlier that used 50-volt, but they didn't use them with any consistency or for seemingly any particular reason. First game of the free ball game. First game to feature a mushroom bumper. And Dave and I went back and forth about whether some of the mushroom bumper styles that were used in the 30s counted or not. This particular one is so different from the way that the others work that I decided to include it. First game of the cattle game. So these are so common in later games. That's a Ted Zale invention. These are still basically in use today. Standardized motor and transformer for US and Euro games. So prior to this, if a company was going to send a game over to Europe, they would have to create a 220-volt version and a 110-volt version. They designed one that was switchable from one to the other. By the way, stop me at any point if you have any questions. First three-ball multi-ball. We can make an argument that there were earlier games with multi-balls, but this was sort of an earnable multi-ball, not one that happened randomly. Anybody recognize those? It's a one-time only Zale design that was their butterfly rollovers, and you can see them right there, used on Grand Tour. I've never actually seen this game in person or played it, but that's one of his designs. Big Day. Now, we can make an argument that there are machines going back to the 30s that had asymmetrical play fields. Pretty much all of the Zale games after this were asymmetrical. And if you look at games from other manufacturers in that time period, they tended to be very symmetrical in their nature. First game to include under play field score reels. So Williams Funhouse back in 56 had these little trap doors that would open up when we triggered the correct switch, but it was more or less you would get the standard scoring feature that was under that trap door when you activated it. Zale came out with it in February of 66. Williams came out with Full House and Top Hand in March of 66, which used a similar mechanism. Don't know who came up with it first, but Ted beat him to the market with it.
Well, yes, we just heard last hour about spying on other companies.
Yes, exactly. That was my thought when that comment was made. First six-player game. It is also the first machine with an left outlane kickback. And I'm going to show you a video in a second. Have any of you ever played this game in person? It's the kickback on it is so different than what came on later games that I had to give you a video. Anybody pick up on what just happened?
Like a saucer under the apron?
Yeah, the ball goes down in there and it's held for a moment before it's kicked back out. It's not the instant kick out that we're used to with those left lane returns. You've probably seen or played Loop the Loop. It's one of his better known titles. Again, it's not the first one to ever use a not across the top of the playfield launch. The ball comes out here, goes around this way, and comes back. It is the first more modern use of that from from one of the mainstream houses. Zipper flippers. Zipper flippers are my favorite. They are a Zale invention. And they were talking about it as early as that Mother is a Pinball Machine article from early 66. By fall, Zale told me a game will be in production. It's top secret now, in which the technique of flipper play will be radically altered. They're referring to zipper flippers there without calling them that. There's zipper flippers open and zipper flippers closed. Say that 10 times fast. You can tell how complicated that mechanism is. And that goes back to Greg Kmick's comment about them have them testing and building these things literally 24 hours a day. I could not get a video of Bizarre, but here's a video of, well, let me play that again, video of Nippet with its zipper flippers. Williams copied the design in Daffy and Student Prince and Doozy and Haber. And incidentally, Hayburners 2 is the only zipper flipper game to use 3-inch flippers. They were threatened with a lawsuit because there was these were exclusive to Bally, and we'll talk more about that in a second. So they had to stop using them.
Quick correction, the Doozy is the replay model and Daffy is the animal.
Did I get them backwards? Okay. The other thing that's interesting about Zale designs, and this is Dixieland for anybody who doesn't recognize it. There were some things he did that weren't necessarily completely unique, but he used them in absolutely torturous ways. So if you look at that outlake, all the way from the top straight down to the bottom, not unrecoverable, but certainly a tough one. Okay. Doggies, I guess it's pronounced, used these little rollover buttons that were about the size of an aspen. There's a couple of them up there, and there's one right there, right under the 50 there. Something that was copied by other manufacturers later. This is the first of the machines to use those. Here's Nippet and the famous Balligator that we talked about. It's sort of neat to see how that feature works. This is probably the most complicated design that they put together. We'll see that one more time. Fireball, of course, it's the first use of a playfield spinner in a modern game, something that we've seen in a number of other games. I played Whirlwind yesterday. But there were prior examples. This Gigolo Electroball is using nails in the semicircle there to pick up the ball and deposit it somewhere. Not designed to just randomly flick it around on the playfield. All right, patents. Here's where we get to the interesting stuff. So it has long been rumored that Zale got his start in pinball Genko. Nobody's been able to prove it thus far. There's your proof. It is a patent for an electromechanical gun game designed by Ted, or at least that particular mechanism for the moving target was designed by Ted, and it is assigned to Genko. So we know that by 1957 he was working there.
It's a Genko surface.
Is that what it's from?
Yeah.
Okay.
Out of the mid-50s.
So what I can't figure out is what he did from being a commercial printer in 1940 until we get here in 1957. He may have been at Genko prior to that, possibly for years, but this is the first of the patents that is assigned to him, and the only one that is assigned to Genko as well. Here's that mushroom bumper that we were talking about. He cited all of the other patents, and this is why Dave and I decided that we would leave this slide in, because he researched the mushroom bumpers that had been done previously, and this was different enough that it satisfied the U.S. Patent Office, so if it satisfies them, it satisfies us. By the way, that's the first of the patents that he did at Bally. These are in chronological order. That is another style of the mushroom bumper that was used on some other games. You can see that it's offset here so that you can't hit it from certain angles. Zale pop bumper with the rocking action. agree with that?
Can I comment on that pop bumper?
Yeah.
What makes this patentable is that the leaf switch does not need the spoon formation. So it's cheaper to manufacture the leaf switch part of it. Because of the way the actuator shaft closes the switch.
Anybody recognize that one? That's the zipper flipper patent, correct. Which they refer to as ball gating and reprojecting means. And a mechanical drawing from the 1969 Valley Parts Manual. There's the ball gate that we talked about before, the cattle gate style. And a patent for one of the other Zale stylized ball gates. You've probably seen these on a number of Valley games, even into the late 70s, they were still using this particular type. And it is that one there. So the lasts of Zale's career, and this is where I have to make a correction to what I said, as I mentioned earlier. The last commercial flipperless release that was from one of the mainstream manufacturers was Fun Cruise in 1966. I cannot find anything after that that you can make an argument was a mainstream production. There are some one-offs or some boutique types of things, but this seems to be the last of the mainstream releases. And I am going to nix this next slide. Joust was the last release from Bally with short flippers. It is not the last release, period, because there are some that go a little later with Gottlieb. Zale's relationship with artists. So this was a really challenging part and will be an area for further research. If we take a look at his titles by artist, the greatest number with 36 is unknown. Almost half of his machines were done by unknown artists. I think there's pretty good evidence out there, but no definitive proof, that George Melentin was the artist for a number of those, and Dave and Ryan and I have identified a stylistic, how would you put it, an archetype from another artist, where there are several that I think can be attributed to mystery person A, if you will. We don't know who it is, but the way that the faces and mouths and hair are rendered are identical across this string of machines. So that will be an area for further research down the road. So if we look by year, most of those unknowns came front-loaded. Anybody want to take a stab at why? What did Bally do in 1963? Want to help him out, Dave?
Got the slot machines.
They went from slot machines and it started including what? They got back into the pinball business.
Yeah, so it is when they started, they really slowed way down in bingos and they filled the gap with both slot machines, real type slot machines and pinball. Amusement pinball.
And they didn't have in-house artists working on these, as near as we can tell. The first ones that he was doing with in-house artists, there's one George Melentin title, and then we moved to a couple of Art Stenholm titles. And it's not until he started working with Jerry Kelly and Christian Marsh later on that you see a lot of titles where he's actually working with a particular artist. So who are these anonymous artists? I mentioned ad posters before. I would like to think in my heart of hearts that this is how Ted got connected to pinball, that he was working for one of these commercial print houses and got to know people and maybe threw some ideas out there. Because it doesn't make a lot of sense for me that a guy who's in his mid to late 40s is suddenly going to change careers after, you know, running a successful commercial print house. So somewhere out there, I'm hoping that there are still records for ad posters in existence. If any of you know how to get access to those, I would appreciate it. But for now, this is the best we've got. We know that Ad Posters was working with more or less all of the companies that were around Chicago at that time, and certainly did a lot of work for Bally that we know of. But I'd like to be able to tie some of those unknown games back to individuals, if that's possible. All right, here's one of the blockbusters. I promised you guys stuff that nobody knows about yet. This is one of them. June 1963, so Bally's been in the pinball business less than a year. Zales showed up there in October or November of 62, as near as I can tell. And by June of 1963, things weren't going so well. Bally was bought out by Bill O'Donnell and colleagues. And sometime in June of 63, a telephone call happened. This is from the Kordak Archives. I don't believe it's ever been published before. This one is courtesy of Duncan Brown, who was incredibly generous in sharing information that he had in the archives. There is what we believe is, as close as we can tell, this is a transcript of that note, because it's a little hard to read his writing. So the engineers all got laid off sometime in May of 63. And Duncan had this to say about it. So ponder that one for a minute. Consider the alternate universe where Ted Zale was not loyal to the cause, or Steve Kordak snapped him up at Williams. Do zipper flippers still get invented? Is Fireball a Williams game? All right, so this sort of got alluded to a little bit in Zombie Yeti's presentation. There's a lot of artistic license that was taken in the business, and some outright thievery. So if we look at one of the early Zale titles, Moonshot from 1963, there was a Gottlieb machine a year earlier called Tropical Isle. Take a look at those play fields. They are virtually identical with different artwork. Even the point values are the same for the most part. Little exaggeration in this one, 50-50, a machine I have not played, but they advertise that split field scoring action is something brand new. That's certainly not the case. Chicago Coin had games like Golden Gloves and Tahiti and football back in 49, and Genko had Merry Widow, and there may have been a lot of other games too. So this was not an innovation, even though they tried to pitch it that way. I don't know if that's something that was being pushed out as a narrative from Zale as the only designer in-house, or if that's something that the bean counters and marketing people came up with. And any of you who are, I see a lot of gray hair in here, you guys are probably old enough to remember the Tiger in Your Tank advertising. Bally's Safari is a blatant ripoff of that Esso marketing campaign in the late 60s. And then Mad World. So back in 1964, I think the movie came out in 63, it's a mad, mad, mad world. Bally comes out with a game called Mad World. Where do they steal that font from? I've seen that somewhere before. They took the Mad Magazine font, blatantly ripped that one off. All right, that brings us to the questions now of the end of Zale's career. When did Zale retire? In Chicago Tribune magazine in 1972, now keep in mind that the last credited games to Zale come in 74. By 1972, they talk about him already being retired and grinding out new play schemes from his home in Arkansas. So that got a bunch of questions going back and forth between Dave and I trying to figure out, you know, when did he actually leave Bally? When did he start designing from his home in Arkansas? And what's the last game he designed? And The chain of events that precipitated this in the last couple of weeks has been really interesting, with both Jim Patla and Greg Kmick weighing in on this one. Again, we're back to that Tropic Magazine article. Now well into his 70s, announced the end of his long career several years ago while he's still designing for them. I should also say that I think that they probably misinterpreted this mobile home thing. Patla is very clear it was not a mobile home. It was like a double-wide trailer that they plopped down in his backyard as a workshop for him. They may have heard trailer and assumed it was that it was something that he was towing around with him while he was designing pinballs. I don't know. So this is a quote that Jim provided to Ryan during an interview that Ryan did for his podcast. It hasn't been broadcast yet, but that'll be coming up at some point in the near future. Jim says he started in 65 and thinks he worked with Ted for about 5 years, which would place his departure sometime around 1970. Greg talks about it in the context of the last games that Ted was working on. So Ted's contribution ended when Norm Clark came over from Williams. When Ted retired, Bally hired Al Gregg. Patla and me reworked Ted's drawings into production quality games. This again is from the Patla interview. So Joust is the first game that that Jim Patla remembers reworking after Ted left the factory. He also specifically mentions having worked on Vampire and Double Up, which came after that, and he said that there were probably others as well, but those are the ones that stick out in his mind because he had significant roles in changing those machines. Joust is September of 69, which means that there were about 5 years where Ted is still sending designs in. That brings into question all of the games that came out in that time period, starting with Ballyhoo, ending with Bally High. We don't know necessarily that Jim's memory is 100% correct on that, or whether, and he said as much himself, that, you know, it may have been that Joust was something he was assigned to work on a particular piece of, and that's why he remembers it. But it calls into question all of these games. Are these things that Ted mailed in from Arkansas, or are they things that may or may not have been worked on in the Bally factory by him? Here's another quote from Patla. So the question was, so that would have been right around the time you designed your first game. Right. Like Four Queens, which was released in 1970. And his response, and that was like my training ground, making changes to Ted's games. So that calls into question, and I wish I had been the one able to ask some of these questions, because I would have asked on the fly whether that means that Four Queens is a Ted design or whether it means that it's a Jim Patla design. But I will say that Jim's memory of this is likely correct, because it's reinforced by this comment from Greg Kmick. I think the last game Ted sent in was Rogo, so named because of the large horseshoe feature in the center of the play field, which caused the ball to go around.
I see the colors.
So for any of you that are familiar with that game, that is a game that is credited to Greg. And he's telling us in these emails that it was not a game that he had designed. It's a game that Ted Zale designed. That leaves an awful lot of games that happened after Fireball and Nip It and Bally High, and until they had a new chief designer in-house at Bally. It's not clear where the breaks are. So that will be an area for further research. Some of the other questions that are remaining is, are there any existing photos of Ted Zale? So I have an aunt who's a professional genealogist, and I asked her to do some genealogical work for me, and she reached out to two different branches of the family through different descendants who have pages on Ancestry.com. Nobody has a photo of Ted. There are no press photos of Ted that are known. There's no candid photos from around the factory that we can find. We offered up a couple of different photos to Jim Patla, and he was able to identify everyone in the photos. None of them were Ted Zale. So I had gotten very excited at one point thinking that I had found the elusive photo, and it turned out that it was some guy who worked on the dock there is, in the Esquire article and in an article from Dude magazine, they talk about an electronic eye that was used apparently on a game that never went into production. I have an opinion that game may have been one called Bullseye. Some of you may have seen, there's a flyer that exists still for that game. There is a schematic for the game that does not specifically show an electric eye, but it's the only game we know of sales that never made it into production one, and that no prototypes or factory demonstrators exist of that game. So Dave thinks that it might have been either a feature that was used on a non-pinball machine, or that it might have been something that they put out there to try to intimidate the competition. Do you know something about this?
No, I don't. I was just wondering, was it a pinball? Did Zale design non-pinball games?
Like maybe shoot a game or something.
It's a gun game.
Yeah. He designed gun games when he was at Genco, and that's, we talked about that before you got here. Once he was at Bally, there were no gun games that there's any records of him having had a hand in. Nothing outside of pinball that he's known to have had a hand in. Doesn't mean he didn't. You know, he might have been working on the slot machines or working with the fellow who was designing the bingos. I don't know. And with regards to Bullseye, that's my next point. Can we find photos, drawings, or an example of Bullseye? Certainly, they built at least one. Patla talks about them having games that were not successful, or whitewoods that they didn't like would go right into the chop saw. But we know from the flyer folder, or the flyer, that at least one full machine of Bullseye was made. So I'd like to think that still exists. We have the question of when Zale arrived at Genco. So we know he was there by the second half of the 50s. We can definitively pin it down by 57. Certainly if he was there, you know, patents, for any of you that have done patent work before, they take some time, meaning that was probably a patent that was submitted in 54 or 55. But that still leaves a gap of 15 years or more in which we don't know what he was doing for a living. So what did he do after Genco closed in the summer of 58, and when he pops back up at Bally in late 1962? I have a theory that I cannot prove, but I'll throw it out there in case any of you happen to know more about this particular facet of gaming history than I do. Dave and I sort of went around and around about this. He was designing gun games at Genco, we know that. Right after Genco closes, a little company called Midway pops up. What's Midway producing right out of the gate? Gun games, from day one. Gun game after gun game after gun game. How are they gonna turn that out without having an accomplished designer in gun games? I'd like to think that he moved from Genco to Midway to Bally. When he pops up at Bally in 62, he's the chief designer from the day he arrives. So clearly he made his bones somewhere, and I just need to be able to prove that. And that's something that, you know, if I'm able to do that between now and next year, I'll bring back a revised version of this presentation for you. Mystery artists. I talked about this already. I'd like to think that those records exist somewhere. Finding them has been elusive. I have turned over more stones and made more phone calls and emails and attempts to contact people through Facebook and email addresses that I find on the internet and such, and that one was a fruitless search. And then we have the question of what machines were made after Nippet and Bally High in roughly July of 73. That's the last documented games he worked on. And before Rogo, which is what Greg Kamik tells us is the last game he sent in. So it calls into question the dozen or so games that came out in that 13-month period. And then lastly, when did Norm Clark join and leave Bally? If we can get access to that information, both Kamik and Patla were very clear that Norm Clark coming to Bally was the end of Ted Zale sending in designs. So my suspicion is that it would be sometime around August of 74, but I don't have definitive proof of that. Here's the comment regarding that electric eye. Thank yous to a bunch of folks. Duncan Brown was incredibly generous in sharing information from the Kordak archives. I've already mentioned Ryan. Earlene Dudley from William Woods University helped with the genealogical research. My buddy Chris was incredibly helpful. He works professionally in the TV industry. Clay Harrell allowed me to use any of the information from his website. Of course, Greg Kamik, Dave, Jim Patla, and Jay Stafford from IDPB, who sent along a bunch of stuff that's not on their site, some of the photos that you were able to see there. I have 3 pages of references. If anybody's interested, you can give me your email address. I can send you all the references if you want to check any of this stuff for yourself. If you didn't guess, I'm an academic, so we document this stuff as carefully as we can. And with that, do you guys have any questions that I might be able to answer?
I don't know if you covered it. What was this first game? The first pinball
was, we can go all the way back to the beginning. It was... That's okay.
Moonshot.
Yeah, it was Moonshot. I was going to bring up the pictures of it. But.
Yeah.
Okay, so Moonshot was basically a copy of the Tropicana.
Correct. And that was one of the slides. Put them side by side. Yeah, yeah. They're identical in that regard. Why is it stuck now? The computer's working hard. This is 150 megabyte file.
While he's stepping back, that the artist credit graphs you see there, that's as IPDB has it, but anyone with an eye for art, in my opinion, could pick out way more Millennium artwork.
And I agree with you. But I am not a professional artist, and what was it that Zombie Eddie said? I am not qualified to make that determination or something. And it's one of the areas that we've been working with Ryan on trying to definitively identify some of those as Millennium designs. Yes, sir.
When did Tenzel pass away, and where he lived?
Baxter, Arkansas, in September 1977.
Is that in Mountain Home, Arkansas?
It is. Yeah, they're basically right next to each other.
I was talking to Wayne Hyams on the phone, a college designer, and he lives in Mountain Home. And he told me that he wasn't aware of Tenzel living near him until he read his obituary. He read the obituary and realized that he lived close by.
Yeah, they're literally like right next to each other.
Didn't know each other like that. Amazing.
Well, they worked for rival companies, and there was not a. These guys that were in here doing the seminars earlier talked about how much, you know, they talk to one another now. Back in the 60s.
Well, I can clarify that.
Sure.
From many expo presentations, that when we say they talk to each other, except Gottlieb.
Yes, that's where I was going.
So that explains.
Gottlieb kept for themselves.
Yeah. And that's one cross off on where was Ted between 1958 and 62. We could probably say not Gottlieb.
Correct. And we can definitively say not Williams, because their records still exist. But beyond that, he could have been with any of the other companies.
Chicago Coin,
Keeney. Like I said, my theory is that he was at Midway, but I can't prove that yet.
You know when Norm Clark left Williams?
That's one of the things that I had on there. I don't know when Norm Clark came to Bally, and that would help us pin down the, because as I mentioned, both Patla and Mick say that the designs from Ted stopped coming in as soon as Norm Clark was there. Don't know when that exactly happened. I think it was probably around August of 74, but I can't prove that.
Was there a design change at Williams? Like after Clark left, maybe who was the next designer at Williams?
That I don't know. Dave, do you know that?
I guess Steve Kordick became more prominent as the chief designer, but...
But he was there prior to that, certainly.
Yeah. I believe that one of the Shalhoub books has some interview material with both Norm Clark and Steve Kordick, so we might be able to chip away at this whole chronology of who left where, when, and where the...
Is there any the machine ever been?
Yeah. And I'm a little out of my depth because I didn't research Williams stuff in all the concurrence.
As I did last year, I can put in a plug for this. This is a convenient place to have lots of nice chronological information. So if I look at the Kordick credits for Williams, he's got a lot of titles in the 60s. This doesn't look like all the titles, just like a quick scan. So, and flip over to Norman Clark.
And of course, Kordick was at Genco. So are some of those games that are credited to Kordick actually early Zale designs? That would be another area for the research if you could, if those records still exist anymore. I'm not sure that they do.
Where's the genealogical part of
it? What do you mean, where did I find all of that?
Yeah, no, like, where does it, like, come into play where it's, like, you, like, have to use that kind of resource?
I found it interesting. It's some of it's stuff that I stumbled upon as I was trying to do other parts of this research. And really, for me, the tipping point was that at some point, Thaddeus Zalewski becomes Ted Zale. There's a name change in there that happened by the time he was in his early 20s, and I just kept trying to go further and further back as I was trying to figure out what he was doing for a living. So, for example, I didn't include a slide here, but in the 1920 census, he is listed as unemployed. He was 19, living with his parents, not going to school, and not working. I didn't think it necessary to include that slide, but I thought that some of the other genealogical stuff was interesting, in part because it shows a man who changed careers at a time when most people are pretty well settled in what they're doing for a living. He was at the very youngest in his mid-40s when he made the jump into pinball, maybe even into his early 50s, and then has this grand career after already having had a career. So I included it because I thought it was interesting. Questions?
Yes, how did this journey of looking into Ted Zale's life start for you?
It started out, the idea that I might do this as a presentation started out as a result of the conversation I had with Dave here last year, because we were talking about the Adiball machines and export to, a lot of them were exported to Europe to get around some of their gaming and gambling laws. And I'll let Dave fill in those details. It's certainly more his expertise than mine. I happen to own a Bally Gold Rush that spent its entire life in the state of New York. And it's very personal for me because it's a machine that I inherited from my uncle who had it from the time that it was less than 2 years old until he passed away, and that was the first, I inherited that machine. It was the first pinball I owned, and it has started the ball rolling, and now I have a basement full. So it was something that just started out of interest, and as Duncan Brown said to me when we first started talking, he's like, well, you certainly, for your first presentation, you certainly jumped in the deep end of the pool. Because as I started to research this, there was just nothing out there. So that goes back again to some of that genealogical stuff. I pulled it in because it's information that wasn't out there anywhere else. I realized that with an audience like this, you guys are more interested in the playfield innovations and things like that, but creating a composite of this guy's life struck me as important because you think of the people in pinball who are, you know, the luminaries that are well known, and we could all rattle off, you know, a dozen names of favorite designers. And if you go and ask those guys whose games influenced them, I bet you the answer is going to be Ted Zale for a lot of them. Because he did so many things that other people hadn't done before. So, in a roundabout way, I hope I answered your question.
Yeah.
Gold Rush, that's the actual wall version.
Yes, and I remember talking to you about that as
well. Yeah, I found one, and I didn't realize right away, and I said, yeah, it's the card says extra wall, and it doesn't have the meter in it. My friend found one, it has replay meter.
Correct, I have.
I was like, whoa, one might say.
And the back glass is different.
So I got a Connecticut, so.
I would bet that it started its life in New York.
Could have been.
Because it was New York, I'm trying to remember from your presentation, New York and Indiana.
And Wisconsin.
Yeah. Also, while Todd Tuckey was giving his seminar last night, his guy back at the shop in Pennsylvania was buying a
bus stop.
If you want to get a bus stop, now you know where one is.
I only need about 15 seconds. I'm really bad. I don't know why. Gordon Flea Market in Allentown, New York. I have New York on there. And the bus stop there. And I'm bringing it to my car, and it had a faded back glass. I said, eh. I wheeled back to the guy. I picked up a bullfight instead, Valley Bullfight.
Well, bullfights are very tight too, so.
Yeah, but the bus stop's kind of rare. I didn't realize how rare that game was. It's kind of hard to find.
Yeah.
He designed Sheba as well, Trezell?
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. Campus Queens. Body only for a head for one.
Well, thank you all very much. I hope this was informative. Yeah.